My name is Daniel Sensi. I am the Mangrove and Deadhead Logging Coordinator for the Florida Department of Environmental Protection. I'm in the Tallahassee office and I work closely with all the districts throughout the state. Today this talk will cover mangrove ecology and importance, as well as a review of the Mangrove Trimming and Preservation Act of 1996. So to get started, just as an overview, we will cover what mangroves are and their distribution. We will identify the three native Florida species, then I'll get into their adaptations and importance. I will also cover the entire Mangrove Act from the intent and delegations to PMTs, exemptions, general permits, and alteration permits, as well as different trimming styles and violations and enforcement. If you are a homeowner joining us today, please keep in mind that I'll be going through the technical ecology section first, and then the second half of the presentation will focus on the Act and trimming regulations. All right, to start, what are mangroves? Well, they are a tropical tree species that are often found in low-energy saline environments. Here's a picture of the worldwide distribution of mangroves. The green along the coast is where there are mangrove forests. As you can see, they are mainly found around the equatorial regions of the globe. I have highlighted an area around Florida on the map in the red circle. And as you can see, mangroves are found all along the east and west side of Florida's coastlines, as well as throughout the calm waters of the Caribbean. There are over 100 distinct species of mangroves worldwide, three of which are native to Florida. These are Rhizophora mangle, the red mangrove, Avicennia germinans, the black mangrove, and Laguncularia racemosa, the white mangrove. In Florida, mangroves have expanded to as far north as Palm Valley, which is just south of Jacksonville on the east coast, and to the northern Gulf coast places like Cedar Key, St. George Island, and Santa Rosa Island near Pensacola. These areas are the approximate limits where you can find mangrove forests in Florida. However, there are some shrub-like individuals that can be found growing along the northern Gulf Coast of Louisiana and Texas. This includes places like the Mississippi River Delta and around Galveston. Because mangroves are a tropical tree species, they are susceptible to freezes. Cold temperatures is one of the strongest limiting factors on their northern distribution. They cannot tolerate extended periods of cold weather or harsh freezes. And the picture on the right shows a black mangrove fringe along a shoreline on Cedar Key. All right, so getting into the different species. The first we'll discuss is the red mangrove, Rhizophora mangle. The red mangrove can grow up to 30 or 40 feet in Florida and even more so around the world. There are extensive red mangrove forests in South Florida. The 10,000 Islands region and Florida Bay is where you can find the largest expanses of red mangrove forests in Florida. Reds can be found as far north as St. Augustine on the East Coast and up to Cedar Key and St. George Island on the Gulf Coast. And they grow best in areas with good flushing from tides and river or surface runoff. Here's some characteristics for red mangroves to help you identify them. They have long pencil-shaped propagules that hang from the branches. These propagules will fall off the parent tree, float to a new location, and take root in the soil. Reds also have the largest leaves of the three native Florida species. The leaves are dark green and waxy. They are tapered at the tip, and the underside will be slightly lighter and will sometimes have black spots. One of the most distinguishing characteristics with reds is their arching prop roots. The prop roots provide stabilization, lift them above the water level, are important for gas exchange, and help to exclude salt from the water taken up by the tree. The red mangrove does have a limitation in that they cannot coppice. This means that they cannot regrow from their trunks, roots, or large branches if they are cut or have been damaged by storms. All of their growth is limited to their branch tips, which are called their meristems. Many branches more than 1 inch thick in diameter will not regrow after being cut or damaged. which makes reds, especially large mature reds, very susceptible to over-trimming. Windowing or window trimming is a type of trimming style that creates a view while also protecting the life and function of the tree. In a window trim, the foliage is trimmed in the middle of the tree, leaving at least a hedge underneath and a foliage canopy on top to allow the mangrove to continue to grow and provide habitat. Many large mature reds do well with window trimming because so much of their foliage is in the upper portions of the tree already. In the photo on the left, you can see an example of some windowed red mangroves along a shoreline. The window provides a view while the hedge and canopy foliage keep the mangroves healthy, provide habitat, as well as some privacy for the homeowners. The photo on the right shows defoliation of red mangroves that were cut down too much. The cut mangroves will not survive, and there is little to no habitat function in the cut area. Black mangroves, moving on, also known as Avicennia germinans, can grow up to 25 to 40 feet in Florida. They have the furthest northern range of the three species and extend through the northern Gulf Coast and almost as far north as Jacksonville on the East Coast. There are even scattered individuals throughout the northern Gulf Coast states of Texas and Louisiana. Black mangroves are characterized by having an underground cable root system, which provides the tree with stabilization. They have what are called pneumatophores, which grow up from the cable roots. The pneumatophores look like pencils sticking up out of the ground. They can be as much as a few feet tall and provide the tree with gas exchange and act somewhat like a snorkel during high tides and water levels. The leaves are the smallest of the three species. They are thin, green on top, and silvery underneath, sometimes with salt crystals. The leaves excrete excess salt that's taken up by the roots. The propagules are much smaller than the reds and look sort of like lima beans. Additionally, the small propagules can be adversely affected by increased wave action, and thus black mangroves are best suited to very low energy depositional environments. They are also the most frost freeze tolerant of the three species, which is also why they are found the furthest north. One ability that helps them survive freeze events is that they can coppice. This means that they can regrow from their trunks and roots if they have been damaged from a storm, freeze event, or even trimming. Oftentimes you may see black mangroves with multiple trunks like in the photo on the slide. The third species is the white mangrove, Lagunculeira racemosa. Whites are the shortest of the three and grow to about 20 to 30 feet in Florida. Their northern limit is about the same as reds or slightly less, which is around the Matanzas Inlet on the east coast of Florida and in Clotty Key on the Gulf Coast. White mangroves have very distinguished leaves. The leaves are wide and paddle-shaped with a small notch at the tip. At the bottom of the leaf, you can often see two small glands. These are called nectaries, and they excrete sugars. The leaves, like the black mangrove, also excrete excess salt taken up by the tree. The propagules are small and flat and are the smallest of the three species. Although the white mangrove doesn't have a specialized root system like the reds and blacks, they do have lenticels along their bark. These lenticels are like little pores that help in gas exchange and allow the tree to breathe when the roots are inundated with water. They have the least frost tolerant of the three, which is also why their range is the furthest south. And all three species, the red, black, and white mangrove, are protected under the 1996 Mangrove Trimming and Preservation Act, which is part of Florida statute. So we talked about mangrove distribution and covered the three species. Let's talk about some of their adaptations. As many of you know, mangroves are a salt-tolerant species, which is what allows them to grow along saltwater shorelines. In fact, they can tolerate salinities up to 90 parts per thousand. For reference, seawater is around 35 parts per thousand, and freshwater is 0 parts per thousand. However, they do not require salt to survive. They simply outcompete other species. Oh. Hold on a second. Sorry about that. So as I was saying, they do not require salt to survive. They simply outcompete other species in saline conditions. This is because they are able to deal with the excess salt in ways that other species can't. We talked about their root systems. The red mangrove's roots exclude salt when they take up water and are often covered in salt crystals. The black and white mangroves take up salt water in their roots, but then excrete the excess salt through their leaves, which can also have a layer of salt on them. Their root systems also give them a competitive advantage for where they grow. It allows them to tolerate large water level fluctuations, whereas other species would drown. The roots provide stabilization in the unstable soils and also help with gas exchange. Here's a picture of black mangrove propagules spread out across the shoreline. Mangrove forests expand by allowing waves and currents to disperse their propagules to new locations. The propagules will take root and establish in the fine-grained soils. And each species' propagules can survive for different periods of time, which are around a month for white mangroves, 3 to 4 months for black mangroves, and up to a year for red mangrove propagules, which is a lot of time for a propagule to float around before it has to find a good location to establish a new colony. All right, now let's talk about zonation and how mangroves are positioned along the shorelines. The images on the right are excerpts from text articles depicting the classic zonation models for mangroves. Going from low tide to high tide, it often shows red mangroves to be the furthest waterward. This is because their prop roots elevate the tree and can tolerate longer and higher periods of inundation. Black mangroves are behind the red mangroves. Their pneumatophores tolerate flooding, and they are the most salt-tolerant of the three species. And whites are behind them. White mangroves have the least adapted root system for tidal inundation and unstable soils, so they are often found closest to the upland vegetation, including exotic species, as well as what are known as mangrove associates. However, the classic zonation is certainly not always the case. It works well as a guide, but is not a hard and fast rule. A variety of factors play a role in shaping a mangrove forest. This includes water levels, salinity, wave action, tides, the surrounding habitat, and even topography. You can have mangrove forests where all three species are intermixed, and any one can be growing closest to the water. Some forests may not have all three species, and others may just have one. Okay, now for some misconceptions about mangroves. Many times people will say that mangroves are land builders. This is not quite correct and gives a false idea to what mangroves actually do. Mangroves can stabilize shorelines and prevent further erosion. They're able to trap sediments around their roots and can grow out further waterward, but don't really build land. Many times people also say that red mangroves are the most valuable and that they are the climax of the three species, when in fact all three species provide value and mangrove forests look the way they do based on conditions in that location and the different adaptations of each species and not based on succession. Now, before I briefly mentioned mangrove associates, are tree species that are oftentimes found growing in close proximity to mangroves and are sometimes mistaken to be mangroves, but are not true mangroves. One such species is called buttonwood. The photo in the top right shows a buttonwood tree. Buttonwood can grow near mangrove forests and will always be more upland as they do not have the same adaptations as true mangroves. One way to distinguish buttonwood from mangroves is that their leaves are alternate. And all mangrove species have opposite leaves, which means that adjacent leaves grow from the same spot on the stem. whereas alternate leaves are stacked. Here's the figure in the bottom right showing opposite mangrove leaves and alternate buttonwood leaves. Buttonwood also produces button-like seeds. Another mangrove associate is the sea grape, distinguished by its large leaves and grape-like seeds. Mangrove associates are not protected under the 1996 Act. And now for exotics. Exotic or introduced species can also be found growing in and around mangrove forests. The Brazilian pepper, also called Florida pepper, is an exotic species that can be found throughout Florida. It is native to South America, specifically Argentina, Paraguay, and Brazil. Because it is a non-native species to Florida, it upsets the natural habitat dynamics. Pepper plants are distinguished by bright red berries along their compound leaves. The berries are toxic and, when crushed, can be harmful to humans and wildlife. Pepper plants should be removed when mangroves are trimmed. Another exotic species is Australian pine. They are native to Australia, Indonesia, and Eastern Africa. Australian pine is easily distinguishable from mangroves. It is an invasive species that has quadrupled in Florida from the 1990s to today. Now, to wrap up this first portion of the talk, I wanted to show a few more reasons why mangroves are so important. We've already talked about shoreline stabilization and how their root systems help to trap sediments along the shoreline. Mangroves provide storm protection as well. They can help to reduce wind, wave, and even flood damage to human developments along the coast. Mangroves are also a key component that multiple other ecosystems rely on. They are a nursery and rookery habitat for fish, birds, and invertebrates. Many commercial and sport fisheries rely on mangrove forests to provide shelter, structure, safety, and a food web for juveniles. In addition to trapping sediments, mangroves can also sequester pollutants from stormwater or river runoff, such as excess nutrients and chemicals. And these heavy metals are removed from the water column, getting trapped in the sediments, and never make it offshore. By removing pollutants out of the water column and trapping them in the sediments along the shoreline, mangroves help to decrease the amount that settle on seagrasses and coral reefs offshore. When corals and seagrasses are covered in sediments, it inhibits their ability to photosynthesize and can limit their growth or even cause mortality. Beaches and coral reefs provide a multi-billion dollar industry to the state of Florida, but it is not only important for mangrove forests to be present along the shoreline, the size and height of the forest make a difference as well. As I've said, mangroves play a key role in the ecology and economy of multiple industries. In total, Florida's marine industry is a $24 billion per year industry, $14 billion of which is just the fishing industry. The tourist industry alone, including beaches and coral reefs, is $53 billion per year. So the entire state has an invested interest in these systems and how they impact these lucrative industries. Like I said before, it makes an impactful difference whether the mangroves are left in their natural state or if they are trimmed to short hedges. A study found that a 5-foot tall red mangrove canopy contributes $144 per acre per year to fisheries, whereas a 30-foot tall red mangrove canopy contributes $6,500 per acre per year. So a mangrove that is 7 times as tall provides 40 times as much value to the ecosystem.